Welcome to the Landmark Theater's Q&A podcast. In this podcast, you will hear a discussion with Director of Photography, Roger Deakins, from the film Sicario, moderated by Landmark Theater's Dan Gorski, recorded at the Landmark West LA.
There's no one here.
Thank you so much for coming tonight.
Pleasure.
This is a visually stunning film, as well as a film that just really draws you in. And I'm just curious how it all starts with you and the director. How does the discussion begin? Do you guys start talking about specific scenes? Do you talk about themes, thematic ideas? Like, what's that discussion like?
Yeah, it is very kind of loose, really. Yeah, you just discuss themes, and I mean, on Prisoners, I sat with Denny and just went through the script and talked about ideas, and you know, you just have a general conversation. I mean, I like to get what the director's idea of the script is, because you know, I mean, you could basically, there's a million ways to make a movie, you know, and it's very a sort of personal thing for a director. So I like to get into their heads, really. But I mean, I love working with Denny because it's such a collaboration, and you can have these conversations and bash around ideas. And it's a slow process, kind of figuring out the way you want it to look, though. Because you talk about the script, and then it just sort of gradually builds, you know, as you get into searching for locations, and you know, you find out who the cast is, and obviously they have an effect on it and everything, you know.
Does he start with like one specific iconic visual image, though? Do you talk about colors? Do you talk about, you know, tones? Do you talk about camera? Sort of a What? I guess I'm more curious what's going on in his head, because
it's more
Prisoners.
Finding it. I mean, it's nothing really. You know, we each. I mean, Patrice, the production designer, would come with a whole kind of mood board for the film and basically research photographs, and then Denny would come with certain images, and I brought a load of images and suggestions of things we should look at, and you know, just have a very loose conversation, really. Yeah, you just sort of slowly find it.
Was there a particular scene that that had to change, or that was really challenging to sort of get to look exactly right because of the weather and what you guys had to deal with?
The hardest one was you know, going across into Mexico to pick up the guy from jail, coming back, and then the shootout at the border, because obviously. You know, we went to scout the Bridge of Americas between, you know, the border between El Paso and Juarez. And they let us walk among the cars, and we walked across the border into Mexico. I thought, this is amazing. Well, I wish I had my camera, but there's no way they would let us shoot there. You know, you couldn't. So that was always the big imponderable until, you know, we were already shooting. And there wasn't really a decision what we were going to do about that. And both Denny and I said, we have to go to Mexico to shoot this. There's no way we can shoot it in America. And it's so crucial to the story that suddenly Kate and the audience is drawn into this world they have no experience of, you know, that's just there, you know, just over this fence. So eventually, it was obvious we had to go to Mexico to shoot it. So we went to Mexico City to shoot it. But we still had the problem about how do you do the shootout on the border because there's no border post. So we ended up shooting that in a parking lot in Albuquerque. It was a big parking lot. And Patrice built this set where, you know, there's like a barrier to the left and right and a big fence, and it was covered in canvas, so you don't see Albuquerque. And then in the far end, we had like 150 or 200 cars, so it was quite big. He built the border posts. But as you drive in, you see out the back window behind Kate, you see there was a big blue screen because we had to put Mexico in that way. And when they drive to America at the end, when they get away, that's also CG because there was a blue screen at that end. But, you know, about 90% of it we got in camera by doing it that way.
Wow. Was there a particular scene that's your favorite, the way it came out?
Not really. I always say this, and it's true. I think the hardest thing, you know, is to shoot a film, make it feel seamless as a piece. You know, so I don't really have a favorite film scene other than the fact that that whole sequence I'm talking about was such a challenge logistically and technically. So, yeah, I was quite pleased we brought it off, and you feel you are on the border, but we were nowhere near it really.
You've worked with a lot of different directors. Do you find that the different styles bring out different ideas in you and how you approach what you're going to shoot?
I really like different styles. I suppose that's why I love my job partly, is that I love, I started in stills and I moved into documentaries. And I really like, on the one hand, I like walking on a set not knowing anything and just doing it with a camera. But on the other hand, I like a lot of prep. With Denny, I like doing a lot of prep. I like thinking about it and talking about it. I like looking at things. But I also like the possibility that you can turn up on the set on the day and just tear it all up and do something totally different. You know, so I'm open to each other. I mean, I've worked with Sam Mendes a couple of times, and really everything with Sam we've made up on the day, you know, with the actors, rehearse with the actors in the morning and just figured it out. On the other extreme with Joel and Ethan, it's like everything's storyboard, everything's really thought out. But again, you can still rip it up on the day and do something totally different. Yeah.
Was there anything that happened like this here where you planned something out and then changed on the day of?
Well, that's a question. I can't really think. I'm sure there must have been. But I think more on this, it was things we'd thought about and they just evolved as you did it on the day. They changed a bit. Nothing dramatically changed that I can really think of. No.
The one shot that really struck me, and I'm sure a lot of people will remember it, is where they're going into the tunnel and you just see that orange-blue sky just really deep, and then just the black figures. That was just so striking. I assume that was completely planned from the start, that was the idea that you wanted for that scene.
Yeah, I mean, we kind of storyboarded that whole sequence again because we didn't have a lot of time to shoot it. And it was a sort of jigsaw puzzle of different locations, and the tunnel itself was a set, you know, the interior. And so you kind of work out how you're going to do it all. I had scouted that location on the hillside, and with a location manager, I'd sort of put stakes in the ground where I wanted to track, and you're going to start here. And I looked at the location manager as he walked the course, and I thought, well, I'm going to do here. I'll put a stake in the ground. I'm going to go from here to here. So it was really, you know, you've got to work that out because you're shooting in, like, you got 20 minutes or half an hour of light, and then you've got to be really efficient, you know. And then, so you know the kind of shots that you want. And you just figure out the best way to do them. I say it's like a jigsaw puzzle. Yeah.
Well, let's get some questions from the audience.
Roger, thanks for coming out. One of my questions I had was, what specific visual references did you have to kind of create this very naturalistic aesthetic for the film?
I don't know, it's funny. The first time I talked to Daddy about a movie was like on Prisoners, and we sort of started talking about, oh, well, should we shoot this handheld? Denny had this real feeling that we should shoot it handheld, you know, this sort of pseudo mock documentary style, and which I've done. I had on a Jarhead and Sid and Nancy I shot basically the whole thing handheld, but it just didn't seem right, you know, and I've lost my train of thought now.
Was there a visual reference though that you kind of like keyed off of to start the ideas of how
yeah
it's
so
look?
I mean my feeling about the film was, I don't know, my reference I think was Jean-Pierre Melville for some reason. I don't know why, but I mean I love him as a filmmaker. He's probably my favorite director of all time. And what I was saying about the handheld, it's like you think you can go in one direction, but you don't have to go that way to get reality, you know. And Melville didn't, like Army of Shadows is an incredibly real film, but it's almost quite stylized, you know. And so, you know, we talked about those kind of things, and that was the kind of my biggest influence, I suppose.
There were several shots throughout the film where there is dust in sunlight. Is there some sort of symbolic representation for that, or was it to set a tone throughout the film?
I don't know. It was just, I don't know. It's just something Denny came up with when we were doing the SWAT house, because we needed, you know, a series of graphic shots that kind of got you into the scene quickly. You couldn't play that. I mean, you could, but you could play it long. You could shoot the whole thing and the guys walking around the house outside, blah, blah, blah. But it would have been excruciating. We wanted to just get into the action really quickly. So it needed a couple of really graphic shots, and that's one that Denny suggested. And then because of that, we thought, oh, well, let's use that again when Kate's lying in bed and just kind of considering. I mean, as you do, it's like staring at the flames of a fireplace, isn't it? It's that sort of idea, really. You know, that's what you do, isn't it? I do, anyway.
Find your own filming style for a student of cinematography.
I don't know. I mean, I don't know. I think you just got to do it, haven't you? And you just do it. It's just practice. It's just use your eyes, take a camera, a stills camera, whatever. Just do it. I mean, I don't know what else. I mean, what are you doing now?
I'm kind of like a short film for school, like a cycle film, and do more practice.
Yeah, I mean, that's all you can do, isn't it?
Maybe try to watch more films and find my preference or something.
Well, I don't think people watch enough films, I got to say. I mean, the other day I was talking to some students and they'd never heard of Jean-Pierre Melville. I could have shot them. Or myself, I don't know which. I mean, come on, guys. I mean, you know, there's such a history of cinema out there that seems to have been forgotten. And it's like we're reinventing the wheel every time. You know, anyway. Sorry,
but also, I wouldn't say that you have a very specific style for it. Like, every movie's different. You know, it seems like you kind of approach each movie depending on what the movie's about and what the directors want. It's always different, right?
I hope so, yeah, because every script's different. I mean, I sometimes say when, you know, if I'm ever go to an interview for a film and a director says, I want it to look just like Shawshank, I'll be out the door like a shot. I mean, because that's ridiculous. I mean, every film, every story demands its own visual approach, really.
So I noticed you shot this on the Alexa. Do you think that you'll be moving more exclusively into digital cinematography, or do you think you'll go back to film in the future?
I've been shooting digitally for, the last five movies, I guess, for quite a while now, except for the last one, which was film. A Coen Brothers movie called Hail Caesar was film, but otherwise I've been shooting digital. Will I go back to film? Yeah, because the guys wanted to shoot film. It was fine. I got a few sleepless nights, but other than that, it's fine. You know, I don't mind. It's, you know, I've been shooting film for 40-odd years, so it doesn't worry me.
But do you approach the whole process differently when it's digital, or is it essentially the same, the setup and everything is the same?
No, I approach it exactly the same. I use a light meter. I mean, it's a little bit more comforting that I have a DIT who's got a monitor on set, which is comforting for me, but I think it's also a great kind of communication tool with a director that you're discussing a shot, for instance. When I was shooting film, I won't tell a director, but I was shooting a film and I said, I think we could play this in a silhouette, you know, profile silhouette, these two actors, like 4 minutes dialogue. Oh, yeah, okay, great. So we shot this scene. I was sitting in dailies and the director says, well, I can't see their faces. And I go, well, okay, here we go. We don't understand what a silhouette means. You know, we have a difference in language. Maybe it's the Atlantic Ocean's in the way or something. But I mean, now I don't have that problem because you look at a monitor and say, that's a silhouette? Oh, okay. You know what I mean? I'm not one of those people like the mystery of cinema, the black box, that only the cinematographer knows what's going into the black box. I think that's all bullshit. I want a complete open conversation with a director. I want to be really honest with a director about what I feel, what they feel, and that's kind of why I like that system, you know.
Yeah.
What did you have to do to capture the weather scenes, like the clouds with lightning and such?
Yeah, we were a bit stupid, really, because when we were talking about the film, we thought we'd have this kind of bland, empty blue sky. And it's, you know, like nothing happening. And then you get there, of course, it's like monsoon season, like with steroids. And so we get these amazing skies. So we go, well, what are you going to do? We have to shoot on that day. So we made it work. And I think we both felt that the landscape was such a character as well within the movie. And certainly became it with the aerials that Denny shot. And so we kind of embraced those clouds and the skies. And one of those lightning strokes is CG, I have to admit. One's not, but one is.
So how did you approach shooting this landscape as opposed to film No Country for Old Men, where it was a very similar sort of aesthetic?
I don't really know how to answer that one. I mean, I think No Country for Old Men is a much less colorful film. I think it's much more sparse. One thing about No Country is there's no soundtrack on it. I mean, there's no music score on it, which is interesting, which we knew before we started shooting. But, I think No Country is, it's a much more sparse movie. It's much more, I'm saying about the sound, you know, you don't have a soundtrack, it's the sound of the wind. So any frame, like when Moss is out with those, you know, the aftermath of the drug bust gone wrong in the desert, it's all about the wind and the sound of, and the dust and stuff. It's a much more leisurely paced movie. For me, No Country still has an equal amount of tension in a way to this film, but it's done in such a different way. It's all about pacing, isn't it? And it's all about those, I don't know. I mean, also No Country is so much more about the dialogue than this film is. So it's, you know, it's not just about the imagery. The whole thing is a different sensibility in a way.
Budget constraints, and did that affect how you made choices?
Well, yeah. But I mean, you know, the thing is about filmmaking, it's like, I mean, you either want to do a film or don't, you know, and like Denny or myself, being approached about a movie, you know what it is you're going into, and you either want to do it or you don't. And a film can be 5 million or 200 million. And, you know, it's probably still not enough in either case, you know. It's, you just got to decide, do I want to make that film? And sometimes, and usually, I think usually the best films, the ones that I am most attracted to, don't command the kind of budgets that, you know, The Avengers does.
The sequences where you have infrared and night vision, do you go through and film the entire sequence in night vision and then the entire sequence in infrared?
we shot a lot of tests with the infrared and figured what we could do with it, and figured that was going to be Alejandro's kind of point of view. He was the one with the infrared system. But we didn't shoot the whole thing on both systems. I mean, at Denny doesn't work like that. I mean, we shot very specific shots for each beat. So the infrared was very much about that one long Steadicam shot going, following the footprints, finding the bodies, getting into the tunnel. And the bit at the beginning. But, you know, it was very specific beats. That said, I mean, we made up a lot the night we were doing it. It was probably as much chaos shooting it as it was, as it appears on the screen, because it, like, you couldn't see a thing, right? Because it's the nature of the beast. The poor Steadicam operator, I felt really sorry for. And the actors, not with the actors, because they didn't have real night vision systems. They had prop things on. So they couldn't see a damn thing.
How do you choose projects?
Yeah, it's funny because you say it's an action film, but it's not really. It's sort of a kind of a character piece, isn't it? I mean, I choose a project the same way as I choose to read a novel. I gotta sort of be connected to it. I mean, I can't work on something just as a technician, as a paint by numbers. It doesn't really make sense to me. So. But I mean, it was easy to choose this because I'd done Prisoners with Denny and I kind of knew what it was going to be. Yeah, you could read it as an action piece, but I don't think that's an action film. You know what I mean? It's like, it's got action, but that's not the purpose of the movie. Where do I choose things? It's a choice. You know, it's the script. If I'm attracted to the script, and then it's like, who's directing, obviously, yeah. And then it's also who's in it as well, you know.
Well, thank you so much for coming out to speak with us tonight.
My pleasure. Thank you. Thanks.